Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Brothers and sisters, welcome to a brand new episode from the second series of Know Your Prophet. We have reached the chapter in Shama'ilun Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by Imam al-Tirmidhi, Babu ma ja'a fi hijamati Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That which has been narrated regarding the cupping of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I'd like to begin this episode just by explaining to you a little bit about what cupping is for those of you that are not familiar. Cupping is also sometimes termed as bloodletting, or is a kind of bloodletting. And it's a kind of medical treatment that you have, whereby a cup or a horn is placed on a part of the body, and either through suction or through creating a vacuum by a vacuum pump or by lighting a fire that sucks or burns out the oxygen inside of the cup, what happens is the cup applies pressure to a certain part of the body. And that heat and pressure, what it does is it causes the blood to gather and make a lump underneath the cup. So if you imagine someone takes a cup or a horn and places it onto your back, and then either through suction or through burning, removes the air that is inside of the cup or inside of the horn, so that the blood gathers together at the surface of the skin underneath the cup, and you end up with a big red lump underneath the cup. Then they remove the cup and they make some very light incisions, i.e. very light cuts, using something like a razor blade or a sterile blade, a surgical blade. They make very light cuts on the skin. Then the same process is applied once again. The cup is applied or the horn is applied, and either the air is sucked out of it. In the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they used to do so by mouth, i.e. just suck it with the mouth. And in these days, they tend to use a vacuum pump, like a pump on the end of a wire, or they use a piece of paper which burns all of the oxygen and the air up inside of the cup and causes it to make suction and heat. And this draws the blood out of the lump. So the lump ends up as congealed blood underneath the lump, and then when you cut it, the blood comes out. And this is a medical treatment that was done by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and indeed that he advised his ummah to do. And it can be done in pretty much almost any place on the body, and the different places of the body are used for different benefits. So when a person has a particular illness, it is done on a particular place, or it's done generally on what they call the sunnah places or the sunnah spots, which are the places where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was cupped in general, for general health, without a specific ailment. So you'll see some of the cupping of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was general, and if there is a specific ailment, then the cupping practitioner knows where to put the cup for that specific ailment. And this is something which has been medically studied in our time, and there is, in all honesty, disagreement among doctors as to its benefits. There are some doctors, particularly non-Muslim doctors, who claim that it has very little benefit or no benefit at all. However, those who are intelligent and those who are aware, and not just Muslim but also non-Muslim doctors, there is a significant amount who believe that this is of great benefit and that it has benefits that medically we are not always aware of, i.e. we don't fully know all of its benefits yet. We presume that there are some benefits in it of ridding the blood of certain toxins or certain substances or other benefits. However, the benefits of hijama have not fully been studied in a medical context to an extent that we can say that we know all of the benefits behind it. However, that really doesn't concern us as much as the fact that there is a sunnah in it, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam considered it to be one of the major sources of cure. And indeed, it is from the advice of the angels to this ummah when they spoke to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they advised the ummah to perform cupping. So it's something that we have as Muslims no doubt as to its benefit whatsoever. And indeed, there are many medical professionals in this day and age that are coming around to the benefit of prophetic medicine, as is the case in prophetic medicine in general. is that we are now living in a time where modern medicine is starting to fail. And that is that modern medicine, things like antibiotics and other drugs, illnesses, viruses and bacteria are becoming resistant. And there is a revival of herbal medicine and prophetic medicine in the medical community in general, or at least in a part of it. There is a revival of the benefits of traditional medicines and from them cupping. So there are medical symposiums, there are conferences that are held all around the world and various institutions and bodies that deal with hijama and have written papers and theses on its benefits. However, from a sunnah point of view, we want to learn what is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with regard to hijama. We know that he performed it. When did he perform it and how was it performed on him and what kind of payment was made? Also, this chapter deals with whether or not it is haram to pay the person who does hijama because of some of the ahadith that indicate that it is a disliked job. That is because in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the people who performed hijama would suck the cup themselves or would remove the air from the cup themselves, and this might lead to some of the blood infecting the person, and so it was considered to be a bad role to have or a bad job to have at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, we're going to see that it was a bad yet an essential job to have, much like the example of the blacksmith. The blacksmith was considered to be a bad job to have because it led you to have a bad smell and often to burn your clothes or to burn your hands. However, it was a necessary job, and likewise the hijam, the one who did the hijama, was considered to be a bad job to have, but it was considered to be a necessary job. And of course, in our time now, with the advent of vacuum pumps and the like, then there is no need for a person to become exposed to the other person's blood or to have to touch the other person's blood because of advances in medical hygiene. And so we could easily say that in our time, it is no longer such a disliked job as it was. But this is all dealt with in this chapter, Babu ما جاء في حجامة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. عن حميد أنه قال سئل أنس بن مالك عن كسب الحجام. Humayd said that Anas ibn Malik was asked about the wage of the person who performs al-hijama. He replied, احتجمَ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حجمه أبو طيبة فأمر له بصاعين من الطعام وكلم أهله فوضعوا عنه من خراجه وقال إن أفضل ما تداويتم به الحجامة أو قال إن من أمثل ما تداويتم به الحجامة. Anas was asked about the wage of the person who performs hijama. And so Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu replied, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had cupping performed on him, which was administered by Abu Taybah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Abu Taybah radiallahu ta'ala anhu was a slave who was skilled in the performance of hijama. And he was a slave that belonged to Bani Haritha, or it was said belonged to Abi Mas'ud al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam interceded on behalf of the slave for his wages to be reduced, i.e. for the amount that he had to pay from his wages to be reduced. The way this would work is that the slave would be given a set amount that he had to earn in each day or in each week or something like this. And this set amount, everything that he earned up to there or less than there had to be given back to his master. And whatever was extra could be taken by him. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam interceded with his master on behalf of Abu Taybah radiallahu ta'ala an. And he asked that his wages that he would have to pay, the tax or the kind of tribute that he would have to pay, be reduced. In some narrations, as we're going to hear, it was reduced from 3 sa' to 2 sa'. And a sa' is an amount of volume which is said to equal 4 times 750 milliliters, i.e. 3 liters, and it is said 4 times 500 milliliters, which is 2 liters. So a sa' is somewhere between 2 and 3 liters. As far as I know, the most authentic narrations make a sa' at 3 liters on volume, and the Prophet ﷺ paid 2 sa', i.e. 6 liters of volume of dates or of some other food. In some narrations it's mentioned that it was dates that he gave. And he gave this to Abu Tayyiba and asked that his master reduce the amount that had to be given back to the owner of the slave and allow him to earn more in order either to pay his freedom or in order to improve his standard of living. And that's all we have time for in this first segment, but we'll deal with more about the cupping of the Prophet ﷺ after the break. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We're speaking about the hadith of the Hajjam, of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Tayyiba, and that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him 2 sa' of food. And we said that a sa', according to the stronger opinion, is 3 liters, and some of the scholars of fiqh said it is 2 liters. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him between 4 and 6 liters of food. It is said that they were dates. وَكَلَّمَ أَهْلَهُ فَوَضَعُوا عَنْهُ مِنْ خَرَاجِهِ. And he spoke to his master and requested that the amount that he had to pay in tribute be reduced. It is said in some of the narrations from 3 sa' to 2 sa'. And the Prophet ﷺ said, indeed the best of that which you treat yourself with, or the best of medicine that you use, is hijama. Or he said, from the most excellent of that which you treat yourself with is hijama. So he either said it was the best, or he said it was from the best, or from the most excellent of things that you treat yourself with, hijama. And that obviously gives us an incentive as Muslims to have hijama performed. And if you weren't aware of it before, you'll find that somewhere near to you, almost everywhere in the world, wherever you are, you will find Muslims who are able to perform hijama for you. It's also worth noting, when it comes to hijama, that there is a dry form of hijama, which is not mentioned in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but is a permissible form of medicine. And that is the same process that we mentioned in the first part of the episode, but without the blood letting, without the escaping of blood. And it's used for slightly different illnesses to the one that is used when the skin is cut and the blood is allowed to flow. And the cutting or blood letting is that which is most common, and that which is mentioned in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. An ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma annahu qal anna an-nabiy sallallahu alaihi wasallam ihtajama ala al-akhta'ain wa bayna al-katifayn wa a'ta al-hajjama ajrahu walau kana haraman lam yu'tih. Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, the narrator said, adhunnuhu qal, I understand that he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had hijama performed al al-akhda'ain, on both sides of the neck. And hijama on the neck is one of the most dangerous forms of hijama. It requires somebody who is quite confident with the blade so that they don't cut too deep and they don't cut something that is going to bleed a lot. And between the shoulder blades, which was a very common place and is probably the most common and the easiest place to have hijama done, between the shoulder blades, and he gave the hajjam his wages, he gave the person who performed it his wages, and if it was haram, he would not have given it to him. I.e. if the job was haram, or the more clear understanding here, if the wage of the hajjam was haram. Because there are some hadith that include the dislike of this kind of job, that this is not a good job to have, and we mentioned the reasons for that. And if it were to be haram, then the Prophet ﷺ would not have paid the hajjam the wage of doing so. An ibn Umar radiyallahu anhuma anna an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam da'a hajjaman fahajamahu wa sa'ala kam kharajuk faqala 3 asu'in fawada'a anhu sa'a wa a'tahu ajra. Ibn Umar narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called for a person to perform hijama, and he performed hijama, and he asked him, how much do you have to pay to your master? either as a daily rate or for every hijama that you do or something like that, how much do you have to pay to your master? He said, 3 sa'. So the Prophet ﷺ spoke to the master and got him to reduce this amount to 2 sa', and he gave him his wages. وعن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه أنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يحتجم في الأخدعين والكاهل وكان يحتجم 17 و19 و21. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu an narrates that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had hijama performed on al-akhda'ain, which are the 2 sides of the neck, and on al-kahil. And al-kahil is the upper part of the back. And this is something again that is from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it's from the most common of the places to have hijama done. And it's from the easiest places to do hijama if you're learning and starting, is al-kahil, which is the upper part of the back. وَكَانَ يَحْتَجِمُ, and he used to get hijama done on the 17th and the 19th and the 21st of the Islamic month. Hijama, brothers and sisters, it can be divided into 2 types. Hijama for an urgent need and hijama for general health benefit. As for the hijama, which is done generally for health benefit, then this hijama has certain times that it should be done and certain times that it should not be done, and certain seasons that it should be done and certain seasons that it should not be done. Most commonly, hijama, at least in terms of the weather of Medina and Mecca, the area where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, would primarily be done more so in the spring than in any other time. And it would not be done, and Allah Azza wa Jalla knows best, as much in the winter. And the Prophet ﷺ used to do it on the 17th, the 19th, and the 21st of the Islamic month. However, what is key here is that this is the hijama for general health benefit. As for someone who needs hijama urgently, because they have a need for it, such as ayn, the evil eye, or a jinn issue, or sihr, magic, or they have a medical problem and they need hijama to be done quickly, then there is no time limit or no time restrictions on when it can be done. It can be done any day, in any season, at any time. And we generally say to people that you should always follow the advice of the medical professional, whether that is the hijama practitioner or the doctor, and you should not break this advice. So if they advise you that you should not have much cupping done, or a certain area you should not be cupped, or a certain time of day you should not be cupped, or a certain day of the week you should not be cupped, then that's good advice that you should generally follow. But in general, we want to establish there's a difference in the Sharia between hijama that is an emergency or is necessary, and this can be done pretty much any time and more or less in any way, and hijama that is for general health benefits, and this should be ideally restricted to the 17th, the 19th, and the 21st of the Islamic monthly calendar, and ideally should not be done when it is particularly cold. And most of the people who do hijama recommend for it to be done in the early morning with an empty stomach, just having drank water with an empty stomach. And they, for example, recommend that you don't eat dairy products afterwards and you don't shower afterwards, so that nothing becomes infected, or so that you don't become sick or you don't become weakened. And there are other advice. Some of them advise you not to eat red meat and such and so forth. But in general, what we say is that first of all, you should follow the advice of a medical practitioner. You should always tell the hajjam any concerns that you have over your health, anything you're worried about, any conditions like blood conditions that might cause the hijama to be problematic for you or for the person who is doing it for you. And then you should always take the advice of the hajjam as well. They have practiced obviously for a long time and they know when it should be done and when it shouldn't be done. From a pure Sharia point of view, we say that for general health, it is recommended on the 17th and the 19th and the 21st. وعنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم احتجم وهو محرم بملل على ظهر القدم. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم performed hijama while he was in ihram at a place called Malal, which is a place between Medina and Mecca. It is said to be around 17 miles from Medina, so close to Medina, on the road to Mecca. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had this hijama performed on the top of his foot. And it seems, and Allah Azza wa Jal knows best, that this hijama that was performed on top of his foot sallallahu alayhi wasallam was done so because of a particular complaint. So hijama on the foot is not really the norm, as in it's not the normal place to have it done for general health. Rather, usually there is a particular complaint, a blood circulation problem, or pains in the foot, or perhaps some sort of irritation or skin problem, or perhaps some sort of problem in the lower leg where the foot is the place to do the hijama, or some sort of pain when walking or riding. So that it seems that the Prophet ﷺ had a specific reason for having it done. And that's why we said that again, in the places you get the hijama done, there are different examples according to what is wrong with you, whether you're getting this done for your general health or whether you are getting it done for a specific complaint. And also the times are different. So it may be that the Prophet ﷺ, when he had it done on his foot for a particular complaint, that this was not the 17th or 19th or 21st of the Islamic month. We don't know, it's not mentioned in the narration that I can see. I haven't come across a narration where it's mentioned the date. But it's not difficult to imagine that this would have been done for a particular need. So perhaps he was suffering a particular pain, or he had a particular complaint that needed hijama to be performed on the foot. And so this is the place that you can perform hijama for certain illnesses. And hijama is something easy to learn, relatively easy to learn. I mean, at a basic level, it's easy to learn. The people who perform hijama have a lot of knowledge about the different places on the body. So they will tell you, if you have a knee complaint, do it here. If you have a foot complaint, do it here. If you have a leg complaint. It's not always the case that the cup is put on the place of the pain. Sometimes it's put below it or above it in order to draw the blood away from it or to draw the blood into it according to what is needed and what is required. But hijama really is an amazing thing. I think it's fantastic. We got to speak about this in an episode. And it's something that if you haven't done, you should have it done, inshallah. As again, we emphasize again very strongly that you should always consult your doctor. And you should always follow the instructions of the person who does the hijama for you. And it's also an excellent thing for you to learn, inshallah. So if you go and want to learn how to do it, then there are classes all over the world. You'll find classes where they teach you how to perform hijama, both in more traditional ways and in modern ways, using things like vacuum pumps, more traditional ways using things like horns that are placed onto the place of the body and then flame is put into it to draw out the air. All of these things are taught all over the Muslim world. So there's a lot of opportunity. It's a great thing to learn. It's of great health benefit. And in general, it does you no harm. Yes, your doctor may not be convinced as to the benefit of it because they may not be a Muslim and they may not realize. However, it generally, for the majority of people, it does you no harm at all. And in fact, it does you a lot of good, as we've seen, because it was so strongly advised by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that's all we have time for in this episode. Until next time, I leave you in the care of Allah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.